fiscal treaty referendum and heard why IBEC and others think a yes vote is necessary for Ireland's recovery.
But opponents have said that a yes vote would spell disaster for the country and lead to more austerity, unemployment and emigration. Here to explain why he will be voting no is Deputy Richard Boyd Barrett from the United Left Alliance. Richard, good morning to you.
Good morning.
Richard, we had Brendan Butler on yesterday and he outlined very clearly to us why this is going to be good for Ireland, good for the people of Ireland, good for the future of Ireland. I'm assuming you would disagree wholeheartedly. Why?
I would indeed. And didn't we hear that story before with Lisbon, how it was we were going to get jobs and economic growth?
But this is a very different treaty.
It's not actually. It's just a further development on a theme which is about locking Europe into a particular economic doctrine, a neoliberal economic doctrine, and effectively outlawing any other type of economic policy, specifically the insistence on reducing budget deficits to 0.5%. And the so-called debt break of having a debt-to-GDP ratio of 60%, what that translates into is brutal austerity, permanently, effectively, and it will prevent governments, democratically elected governments, from being able to have a different economic
policy. Okay,
and
Richard, already the battle lines have been drawn, right? Because yesterday, Brendan Butler said this is a stability treaty. You're saying it's an austerity, so we can see where the both camps are going to come from. But he will say this is about, and you mentioned budget deficit, he will say this is about housekeeping. We have proven ourselves to be singularly either incompetent or incapable of managing our national budget, and this is a way of ensuring in the future that we will.
Well,
so
first of all,
not welcome that?
Well, first of all, from his point of view, of course, it is stability, because it's the stability of the financial system which was the thing that actually crashed the Irish economy and the European economy.
That doesn't mean we don't need it, though, Richard. We can't
function without
stability.
But should we sacrifice? The question is, should we sacrifice everything? Employment, the prospect of economic growth, social justice, in order to protect the European financial system and the private financial system. Of course we need a financial system, but the question is, should that financial system be under our control? Should its objectives be directed towards the needs of the population, towards fairness, towards creating jobs, crucially at the moment, creating jobs? Effectively, this treaty will outlaw public investment. Now, when you consider that the background to the current economic crisis is a collapse of private investment, resulting from the collapse of the private financial system, who else is going to invest? Well, the only people who can invest when there is effectively an investment strike from the private sector is the state. But this treaty will outlaw, for all intents and purposes, state public investment. And that means it is a recipe for permanent mass unemployment.
Well, now, hang on a second. You say outlaw, and again, all these pejorative terms will be bandied around. Stability, austerity. The state has been singularly bad with its investments. It has wasted it. We can give you a million examples, from e-voting machines to overruns on the tunnel, etc., 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 etc. Surely new, stricter controls coming in will ensure that they do what they're supposed to do with the money, that we, the citizen, because it's our money, will get better bang for our buck, and that the money will be targeted properly, that they won't be wasting it. They won't be using our money to buy elections and get themselves re-elected for 10 years. Surely something that would be something you'd welcome.
No, of course we need radical political reform, and of course the governance of this country over the last 20, 25 years has been appalling.
It's been a disgrace.
But ask yourself why, and what was it? What was government policy directed towards? And for the whole period of the last two decades, government policy was directed towards deregulating the financial sector, privatizing more and more sections of the economy, and politicians paying themselves at an equivalent rate to corporate CEOs, right? So they were mimicking much of the corruption, if you like, that we have seen in the public realm, has been because the public realm was mimicking what was going on in the private sector, in the financial and corporate sector, which, let's remember, when we're looking at the current economic crisis, it was what happened in the private financial system, among private developers and among corporate elites who were driven by nothing but greed, that collapsed the economy. And now the people are being asked to pay the price for
it. Richard, if what this treaty is proposing had been in place when Europe was originally established, we wouldn't now find ourselves in the current position we're in.
No, that's not actually true. It's not just me who's saying this, but the United Nations Committee on Trade and Development, for example, made the point recently in their analysis of the current economic crisis that the huge budget deficits and the debt burden that now is suffocating the European economy resulted directly from the financial crash. Now, there were other problems in Ireland, primarily the fact that taxes on wealth were lower down to absolutely unsustainable levels. So those are problems we have to deal with ourselves. But the reason our debt burden has ballooned is because we've taken on the gambling debts of private financial institutions, and because of the economic crisis caused by the financial collapse, we now have nearly 500,000 people unemployed, and if you like, that has to be paid for
and
by the public.
And your point would be that a yes vote would copper fasten that situation?
It will absolutely lock us into it on a permanent basis.
Well, look, we're going to have to leave it at that. That's just the opening salvos. I'm sure we'll talk to you on numerous occasions.
We will indeed. Richard, pleasure. Thank you.
Thanks very much.
Now, coming up after the break, we are going to be discussing the strategic